Yeah. Those goosebumps every time, yeah. You come around, yeah. You ease my mind, you make everything feel fine. Worry about those comments, I'm way too numb, yeah.
Union Street is home to some of the most popular bars and nightclubs in Plymouth, connecting the city centre to Devonport. Dating back to the early 19th century, the Strip was known as Plymouth's hub of entertainment. Similarly, in the modern day, it has become home to popular venues, ranging from cocktail bars such as Revolution, to Stonegate's bars and clubs, Walkabout, Fever, and Popworld. In recent years, there's been a suggested demise in both Union Street's appearance and infamous reputation, making it difficult for new businesses to thrive on the Strip. Around 2 years ago, the DEPO, which is an independently owned club, opened, becoming the go-to place for those who enjoy house, techno, and drum and bass music.
Fucking, let's have it, bro.
Yeah.
We started looking for our own venue. We're like, it must have been 2018. We were like, fucking hell, can we ever own a venue to do it? Ran the numbers, checked out a place where it used to be next to the Hanging Gardens, which not the Hanging Gardens, but like on the adjacent to it. It's called Baba's Indian Restaurant. It's an escape rooms place now. Looked in there, looked really promising, but the business rates were like fucking astronomical and we were like, we can't make it work. Then we looked at the cinema and the Gala Bingo place next to it. And this was in 2019. We checked it out, speaking to the estate agents, and they were doing a 6 month temporary lease. And we were like, look, we can make this work. We can do 6 events a month, earn some money and do fucking class events.
Since then, it has grown, hosting some of the largest live music events in Plymouth and sustaining an audience that has shown continual growth, drawing crowds from across the country. Founders Ryan Platts and Ben Jewel Carey took over the 750-capacity venue, creating a permanent home for event and entertainment company, Casa.
Casa had kind of grown legs and started to walk. I was talking to my now business partner, Ben, who I do everything with. He had begun Casa with his two uni friends as a business project. Asked if I wanted to play. I literally came back from my first season on Ibiza and he said, oh, do you want to play at this, our new night, Casa? And I was like, yeah, fucking course. And that was, I was just talking to the Tanner then. That was in Switch upstairs,
oh, yeah,
which was called Bang Bang back in the day. You could get like 40 people inside it, bruv, and it was, mate, the party was just fucking class. It was so cool. It felt like Ibiza, and I'd just been there, really. So we did 3 events there, then moved to the Live Lounge, which is I think it's OMG now on the Barbican, little tunnel.
Yeah,
on the Barbican, which is kind of where Casa got its popularity from. We started at Thursdays at North Hill, Fridays at Live Lounge, and then we moved to Saturdays at the Hub once we got told off for being too loud at the Live Lounge, we had to leave.
Yeah.
Then we moved to the Hub on Saturdays, as well as kind of trying to push Casa in different directions, kind of like unique location events, which is I think what we're known for now. The biggest one, well, the first one we did was the Screen One rave in a cinema. And that was kind of the turning point for Casa to be something which was like a bit of pocket money, a kind of like a little hobby on the side to a substantially a fucking job. Yeah. Actually, it was something where we could both stop our full-time jobs and concentrate on this. And if we did concentrate on that, then it would multiply and develop and get something bigger.
Yeah.
Hence the club.
Whilst live performance is the most integral part of the nightclub, the DEPO announced the opening of their very own studios in 2022.
If you're into it, we've got these spaces and we can turn it into a studio. Came downstairs in the office, had a big chat, and we were like, fucking, come on then, let's fucking do DEPO Studios. And this was 4 months ago, 4.5 months ago. And then that also evolved into, we don't just have 2 studios to hire out. We've also got spaces above the club, which we can turn into DJ rehearsal spaces. A bit like Pirate Studios. It's not the same as Pirate Studios. A bit more, I would say, a bit more personal. It's not, there's no, like, you don't just go in and fucking do what you want. We're here all the time. It's very much for DJ practicing and not fucking the sesh. It's not for fucking 50 of your mates to come in and have a big party. That's not really what, you can go downstairs for that. So yeah, it was more towards fucking budding DJs, people who want to do podcasts, radio stations, fucking whatever, get in there. And it's treated, it's got a massive sound system in it, and it's just a really nice thing to be able to offer everybody. Then we finished it, and we were like, right, time to launch, and it's been received amazingly. We've got bookings fucking coming out of our ears, to be fair. The DJ rehearsal space, got DJ lessons, studio hire, vocal booth stuff.
Despite all of this growth, Platt stressed the financial difficulties and obstacles that the club has had to face since its opening.
Fucking running shit events, spending too much money on headliners, and not selling enough tickets. That's a big obstacle, and something that's a constant worry. It's not a constant worry. It's more like I was saying, with Chasing Status or Pete Tong or Patrick Toppin, they're guaranteed sellout shows. So there's not really much to worry about, apart from running the nightclub. People like Shapeshifters, Mungo's Hi-Fi's, like, there are some where we're like trial and error, and these can be like 3-4 grand acts who we'll sell maybe 100 tickets for, get a grand back, and we're like, shit, we've made a loss. And like, if you do 8 of those losses in a month, that's like 100 grand. Sorry. 30? But any loss is bad in our terms.
Yeah, cool.
So yeah, that's a constant obstacle. Making sure the bookings which we get are directive to the demographic and the market who want to come and see those acts. Sometimes we get it wrong, and fucking pay dearly for it. We've not got a fucking huge bank account with millions of pounds in it. It's fucking. Everything's kind of on the line, and sometimes we make money, sometimes we lose money. Yeah, that's about it, I think. Staff aren't really an obstacle. If you get core staff members and treat them well, they'll fucking, you know, we've got some of the best staff in the Southwest here. I would say all of them are, actually. They're just fucking second to none in every single thing they do. They're amazing. So that then limits obstacles for us as organisers and owners, because they look after it, because we look after them.
Just across the road from the depot is Popworld. Popworld became known in 2015 following a £400,000 revamp. Since then, they have had a steady influx of customers, appealing to an older demographic predominantly, but also catering to students on particular nights.
Yeah, so every Wednesday night, it's our student night up until midnight, and certainly up until midnight, because obviously the trend is that the students come, they go to like the roundabout or some theater or something, they're coming here, and then go to look about at midnight. So we're just on the usual Dunathumi course. That's mostly when we cater to students, and a Thursday, we're trying once a month. Whatever, once every couple of months is usually more like it. I got Taylor Swift nights and the Harry Styles nights, and we've got an ABBA night coming up 1st of June. They're much more student oriented because the way we promote them is to people that we use Fat Soul Learn and stuff like that, and buy the tickets preemptively. And yeah, so that's generally when we cater to the younger crowd. It's just the weekday nights, because that's not when the bulk of our clientele is.
COVID-19 was a global pandemic that first hit the UK in January 2020, and it had a huge impact economically, which hit the hospitality business hard.
So this site in particular, it couldn't open. So we were told, bear in mind at the time I was doing choreography work here, we were told that we wouldn't shut because of COVID when it first started becoming big and like known. We're told we wouldn't shut. At the worst case scenario, we'd shut for 2 weeks, clean up, like, sanitize everything, reopen. So everyone else got the same spiel about 2 weeks. obviously that's not how it works. 2 weeks got pushed to 4, got pushed to 16, it just kept going on. This site is one of the few that was the last to open, because we just didn't have space. I mean, you've seen it downstairs, it's just not the space to do table service and have a one-way system, really. We just couldn't open at all. So, yeah, we struggled. all of the staff had to go work in other venues and stuff like that. So I myself ended up working in the Roundabout, Fever, Walkabout. I was working 3 venues at once at one point, as well as coming back here to get it reopened. So last year, our figures are compared again. So generally, your figures are compared against the year before. Last year being the first proper year open after COVID, we were compared against 3 years ago, so pre-COVID. And a lot of the figures were down for everywhere. Like, percentage-wise, we took a hit because of COVID, for sure. People just can't afford to go out in our experience. Like, a lot of our crowd is like mid to late 20s plus. We get a lot of, the older crowd in, so like middle age, stuff like that. They have families, they have responsibilities, they just can't afford to go out as much as they used to.
This was more significant in those without the financial backing of already established corporate businesses, such as the Depo.
We were literally about to sign the contract to take it. And because they were wary of us making it a success, which would have stopped their 6-month tenancy, they would have had to have continued it longer, they pulled out of the agreement. And we were like, shit, fucking, that's the end of that. Yeah. 3 months later, COVID happened. So we were like, holy shit, it was a huge amount of money to pay. Like, it was like $2,500 a month, plus rates, plus this, plus that. And if we had signed on that day, in COVID, we would have still had to have paid that money.
Yeah, of course.
So in hindsight, actually, great that we didn't sign. Back to 2019, COVID had just happened. We get a call from the ex-promoter from Crash Manor, Matt Edwards. He says, guys, I'm thinking of leaving. He knew, like, kind of rumours were around we were looking for a venue. And he basically said the Crash is up for grabs if you boys want it. I don't think anybody else can make it work. And we were like, nah, fucking absolutely not. Fucking shit location, fucking real bad name, bad rep, Union Street. And we were like, nah. And basically then just like shelved the whole ideas. The fact that that no one would have been out for a year and a half until we opened wasn't even in our remit, because we were thinking COVID's going to finish in a minute and everything will open up. Anyway, he agreed. And we were like, cool. So we met Matt, and then we met the owners, Steve and Dave and Jill, came up with a business plan, profit and loss, blah, and said, we think we can make it work. Came up to a great contract, great agreement. And on the 4th of November, 2019, we signed the contract for this building.
Yeah.
We did all this in 10 months, not knowing if we could open on particular dates, because Boris kept putting it back. COVID was still here. So whilst COVID, I don't know if I should say this because we weren't isolating.
Yeah.
But basically, like, we were in this club doing this for 10 months. From November, and we opened June, 21st of June, July? 19th of July, I think.
There is only 140 yards between these two clubs, along with other competing venues decorating Union Street. And this is what they had to say about their competition.
I think we work pretty closely, because we all take a different sort of crowd. We have different music. We make a point of being different to each other, so we're not taking each other's stuff. Fever, for example, they used to have a cheesy backroom. I don't know if you remember it at the time. Their backroom used to be all cheesy music like we play. And they changed that to make it more of an urban style, just because it didn't make sense for us to be competing with them against their backroom. It was too much of the same thing. So people end up being split. So it makes sense to just compete against the other local venues that aren't Stonegate. So Fever will compete more with Depo, and we'll compete with things like Rewind down on the Barkfield. And the new place, I think it's Rewind. We'll just try and compete with other non-Stonegate clubs and work together through that. we work closer with some Stonegate places than others, so we don't have an awful lot of contact with people like the roundabout or something like that, because it's not so much our thing. We do discuss things with them, help each other out with stock, hit staff, things like that, as much as you possibly can. But yeah, clientele wise, we don't tend to try and compete with Stonegate too much.
We offer the complete opposite of what they do. We are events based, events driven. We don't open the doors. They're all good. That's cool. You know, everything that they do is good. It's corporate. In my eyes, it's loveless, soulless. It doesn't really connect with you when you walk in. You're just there to get pissed and listen to fucking shit music.
Yeah,
I would say. I don't want to badmouth anybody. This is. We're passionate about what we do, and like I say, we're events-based, we're events-driven, which nobody else is. And we thought, that's either going to work or it isn't going to work. You know, we can guarantee when we've got acts like Chase and Status and Eats Everything this weekend that they'll sell out because they're fucking massive. But on nights where we can't have 8 huge headliners every month because we'll run out of headliners, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And run out of money. So we do have quiet nights. That's kind of evolved from opening the club. We were like, yeah, we'll get this headline. Then we did them all. We were like, shit, we still need to open. We've still got bills to pay. We've still got staff to pay. So that evolved to the Indie Tuesdays. It evolved to the Fivers In on the Fridays. In the summer, we do a Fivers In drum and bass night. People come in, pay a fiver. You've got locals playing. And it's class. We're doing like ABBA shows, we've got drag shows, then live music kind of now is starting to go in with what we're doing, which wasn't possible before because of COVID. If one band member had COVID, the whole tour would be closed or cancelled. Now that's kind of going, which is something we love, to put on some live music. Again, when I was talking previously about the genres and why not being able to offer that everywhere else. To everyone else. We can now do that because COVID's allowed it to, really. Not really fearful of them. I think we've fucking put our stake in the ground and said who we are, almost from the offset, really.
Despite their differences, Popworld and DEPO are very similarly ran, with passion for what they do being evident in their night-to-night lives. I get those goosebumps every time.